and welcome to Kaido with me, Andrea D'Souza, your host for this show. It is rightly said that change in this world is the only constant. We humans have evolved, we have changed, we have progressed. And over the years, things have changed so much and are so different. But change does bring goodness, it brings progress, but there are also some bad aspects to it. Consider the internet, for instance. Just a click, just a Skype, and your loved one abroad is near you. Or for instance, it makes people so connected. And then on the other hand, one compromising picture is just a click away from being public to the whole world. Your internet details, your account details can be hacked just like that. The internet, a boon and a bane. Today, let us talk about cybercrime and the law. And we have with us Dr. Saba De Silva. He has done a medical biochemist by training with a master's degree from Goa Medical College, holding a B.Ed. degree and a master's degree in law, additionally to a Ph.D. in law. He has joined as a lecturer in law at G.R. Kale College of Law, Margao, 17 years back, and was elevated to the position of principal a year ago. He is the member of the Board of Studies in Law of the Goa University. He has several publications to his credit, both in pure sciences and in socio-legal sciences. Welcome, Dr. De Silva, and thanks for being a part of Kaido.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you. So we are talking about cybercrime. What exactly is cybercrime?
See, basically, we are living in an e-age today. Mm. And when I say e-age, it's e-governance, it's e-commerce, it's e-communication and e-security. Mm. And with all this, makes all of us part of the cyber world. Mm. And when I say cyber world, we're talking about the use of the internet. Mm. And just like there can be problems in the use of technology, there can be also legal issues coming out with the use of technology.
True.
Now, cyber crimes are not really defined because they have been covered in various legislations. There is the Information Technology Law.
Okay.
There is the Indian Penal Code. Mm. We also have the NDPS Act, which was for narcotic and psychotropic substances,
okay,
where they use the internet.
Yes, they do, of course, yes.
And of course, we also have the Arms Act, where you can deal in arms.
And you can do it over the internet. True.
So all these together are actually cyber crimes.
Okay.
But then, cyber crimes could be, in short, seen as a combination of a crime and a computer.
Okay.
And then you have the narrow version, you have the broader version.
Mm.
The narrow version talks about basically just a computer crime, where you actually use the computer, you direct it towards a target, or towards use it as a tool.
Mm.
And the broader version is where you have not a computer crime, but a computer-related crime.
Okay.
Like you use the computer for doing the real-world crimes.
Okay.
Crimes
like
which the crimes which are done ordinarily without the use of computers, now you use computers to facilitate, to aid your crime.
Okay.
So that becomes a computer related crime. So in short, this whole kind of gamut is using the computer as a target or a tool.
Okay. So basically conducting a crime, but in this case using the computer to do
so
it.
So using the internet.
Internet.
Basically.
Okay. So what are the salient features of this?
The salient features, when you talk, you're talking about the legislation, you mean. See, what happens is that till about the year 2000, there was no law. There was no specific law for the internet. And apparently in the year 1994, internet was there, but there was no law. So this is one of the cases wherein the law came after the
actual
the
thing.
Act. It's like the chicken and the egg story, what
okay,
comes first.
Huh.
So then we had the Information Technology Law, which was basically an universal approach. The whole world over, they were trying to make information technology laws for their country.
Okay.
And in India, we began with the Information Technology Act in the year 2000.
Okay.
We had an amendment in the year 2008. And the rules are in place. But Information Technology Act is not only for cyber crimes per se. It is for e-governance. So it is to facilitate your e-commerce.
Okay.
It is to recognize digital signatures and to facilitate commerce.
Okay. So cybercrime is a small niche part of
just
it.
It's a small component, small but still large.
Yes, large on its own,
magnitude
of course.
Of being a crime.
True. true.
Basically.
Okay. So this law basically governs everything when it comes to E, that so, is yeah, the internet. Yes, okay, yes, fine. Yes. Now, when it comes to the IT law, we can basically categorize it into four major things when it comes to cybercrime And those are crimes against person, crimes against person's property, crime against the government, and crimes against society. Yes. So let's discuss these crimes one in detail. Like, what is crimes against person?
See, the person is the subject matter of the crime. So one of the most important crimes in this category is cyber stalking. Okay. Now, stalking means basically an obsessive attention towards someone. So people can physically stalk another and, you know, follow another.
Yeah, follow a person walking
home. But here we don't follow physically. You follow using the internet. So you use the computer, you use your email, you use your
Facebook, social media, and
you haunt the person. So this is a cyber crime because this you are intruding into the space of the person, private space of the person. It's just one crime.
Okay.
There are several others. We have, for example, hacking.
Okay.
And hacking basically is an unauthorized access. Likewise, you have something called cracking. And cracking is where you are actually removing the copyright protection, which is part of IPR, in respect of some commodity which you are not supposed to. So you remove the rights and you try to use them. So we say he has cracked a code, he has cracked a secret code. All this cracking is again a violation of the person, because the person
has
it's a person's right.
Okay, his
the copyright
right.
is a personal right.
Of course.
Likewise, you have something called defamation, which was always there in what we call real world. We use this concept of real world and cyber world.
Yeah.
So defamation was always there in real world. But true. Now you're using the internet and you're spreading this, you know, this notion which is basically affecting the good reputation of another.
Of a person.
And you are, making yourself.
And here it's not only one, two people who actually are,
It's the whole world.
And as I said, at one click, the whole world gets to know
certainly,
whatever it is that you're
certainly.
Trying to
so,
see.
Like defamation, you have other online frauds. Mostly it's in the banking sector, wherein you find that some confidential details of someone are known. Now, how do you know that? You know it by creating a website which looks like the original. We call it phishing.
Yes.
Phishing with a PH.
Yeah.
It's a phishing with a PH. And as a result, the person who has created this fake site, so as to say, he captures all your details, he captures your passwords, and you are an innocent victim because you are falling for the genuineness of that site.
Because unknowingly it's say XYZ, XYZ, X.
Yes.
And you don't see that extra X.
Small character for Amazon might end with, you know, instead of an on, N or something like
very
that.
Very true.
So you fall for it.
And it looks very similar.
It says place your password. So you do that.
Yes.
And then you are the victim of an online fraud.
Okay.
Likewise, we have child pornography, which is one of the most serious areas today. Because pornography was always wrong.
Yes.
And even the Indian Penal Code looked at pornography through the provisions of some sections called obscenity.
Okay.
But here the worry is that you're using electronic devices, you're using the internet, and you are transferring and sexually exploiting minor children.
True.
So
true.
Apart from it being a human right violation, a sexual wrong, you're now increasing its magnitude with the use of the internet. So these are, I mean, some of the most common crimes that we say are crimes against the person.
Person. Okay. Now, let's go to crime against a person's property.
Yeah. So, now, actually, we must realize one thing, that whatever crimes we discuss, they basically were always there in the real world. So, you have property-related offenses even otherwise.
Yes.
You have theft, you have robbery, you have extortion.
Okay.
Now, here what happens is that you are affecting the property, which is the hardware, you may say, of the computer. So typically the wrong there is virus generation. You transmit a virus. So what do you do with this virus? You have a malware program. You have something wherein you affect the computer, the hard disk, the files. And what you have done is you have affected the maybe the business of that particular organization or whatever he felt is his property, and you have used the internet as the medium. And in that sense, it is a cyber crime, which is a crime against the property.
Person's property.
Likewise, there are many private offenses in the sense affecting the private rights of individuals. You have something called cyber squatting. Now, typically squatting means sitting
you
in
go
a place.
And you, yeah.
You take up a place.
True.
So in cyber squatting, what happens is there will be an individual who actually, you know, takes or lays a claim over a domain name of someone.
Okay.
So he says, this is my domain. So they become, you know, disputes between one and another. The
okay.
public are not really affected,
huh.
but the property of
yes.
the victim is affected, and that's where courts
because
have
that's
to,
my domain and that's my
domain.
Property
exactly.
So and many people do business through it, so it's their livelihood.
Exactly.
You know? Yes.
So that's where the courts have to sometimes, you know, come to a conclusion as to whose domain it was. So there are private rights being decided, but they are still crimes against the
property.
Okay. Then you have cyber vandalism, wherein you deliberately destroy or you damage the public or private property using the internet. So here we have, you know, destroying data.
Yes.
Destroying data in a network. So this again becomes a property. So I'm making this comparison because nothing is unique about cyber. It was always there
in the real world.
But it's getting a flavor of the internet in it.
Yes.
So in this particular case, we have a vandalism. Mm. And likewise, you have the very commonly heard of IPR crimes, the intellectual property right crimes.
Yes.
So here you have your trademarks, your copyrights.
Mm.
Now there is an infringement of all of these using the computer
internet.
As a medium or the internet as a
okay.
as a medium.
So basically at the end of the day it's doing whatever we do on a normal world, but in this case we use the internet to
true,
do it.
True.
And
true.
Things that are illegal.
They're illegal, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And punishable,
okay.
obviously.
Okay. Now coming to crimes against the government.
Yeah.
What
now, this is actually, we would call them the large-scale crimes.
Mm.
Who would normally come in the way of the government? See, in the real world also, these crimes were there. You had sedition. You had waging war against the government.
See, I was just thinking, like, say a terrorist, you know.
Yes.
An uprising against the government.
Exactly.
Something like that.
So, in fact, cyber terrorism is one such offense.
Okay.
Wherein this terrorism, which is political or otherwise, gets the magnitude of a whole worldwide kind of web, and that's what cyber is all about. So you use internet to terrorize, you use internet
and to spread
to
your
have
agenda
warfare. Yes.
Yes, you know, you spread your agenda,
your agenda
for warfare, whatever.
For warfare, wherein basically you motivate others, you incite in them hatred, contempt against the government, the duly elected government, or even other ways of, you know, political, what do you call, differences.
Yeah, political unrest. Basically.
So these are crimes which are commonly seen as crimes against
the government.
The government.
Okay. And okay, I think we have almost dealt with all the possible crimes that can be out there. But there's yet one more, that is crimes against society at
yes,
large.
Yes, yes. So,
so
what happens
what
to the society is basically we have something called online gambling. Again, gambling is wrong.
Yes.
And gambling can be the real world gambling also.
Mm.
But when you when it takes the flavor of allowing persons to, you know, become victims of this lucrative kind of business, which is per se illegal, with the use of the internet.
Okay.
And I think internet, which was meant to facilitate life and do good.
Yes.
Also, as you said, has a
it has its bad side,
of
course.
And we find that internet gambling is started. It's got a term called iGambling today. I for internet. So there again, the cybercrime, online lottery, you can call them scams. You might have heard of the Nigeria lottery scam.
Yes.
Yes.
That you won so much money in this country and you need to put in this much money to get
exactly.
it, everything.
And people are victims because there is always that little, you know, temptation that why not?
Yeah, let's just give it a try.
Give it a try.
You know, if I'm going to get, say, 50 lakh rupees and put in 50,000, why not?
Yeah, why not? And they incite you into it by giving you that little, you know, you have to pay this little bit and you get this much more.
True.
So that's an online kind of a gambling. And of course, then we have cyber trafficking, which again, trafficking in humans was always a real world crime.
True.
But here you use the internet to, you know, create or to permit this illegal agenda to become a worldwide phenomenon. And you definitely need the internet if you want to transport human beings across the world.
And I can imagine it would be easier actually with the internet than without the internet.
Than without the internet.
And that's the sad part of it.
It flourished without. And now you can
imagine.
With
the internet you can imagine what's the scale of operations that's going on.
Magnitude is really high.
Very true.
And very worrying actually.
Very true. So we are talking about cyber crimes, and it's actually pretty
heavy.
It's exactly, heavy is the correct word, because there are so many things that come under cyber crime. And as I was saying, yes, the internet does bring you close to your loved ones, and it's so nice. That's just one aspect of it. I mean, it's so good, you know, but then there are also negatives to it. We saw what are the cyber crimes that are out there. See you on the other side of the break as we discuss about how, in case you are affected by any crime that is related to the cyber, how you can actually go and seek justice. See you on the other side of the break.
This is Infomedia Prime Slot Network. And you're watching Prime. Your voice, your channel.
Hello and welcome back to Kaido with me, Andrea D'Souza, your host for this show. Today we are discussing about cybercrime. What is cybercrime? We spoke about the four main types of cybercrime. And now with Dr. De Silva, we'll be speaking about what are the punishments for these cybercrimes. I'm sure the punishments vary from the minimal to the huge. But if a person is, say, accused, and if it's proved that a person has engaged in these forms of cybercrime, what kind of punishment are we looking at?
See, the punishments vary in the sense that there's nothing really small when it comes to punishments under the Information Technology Act. But when a person is charged, they are charged under sometimes more than one law. For example, they could be charged under the Arms Act and the Information Technology Act.
Because what they were doing was they were dealing with arms. How? Through the internet.
Through the internet. Oh, okay. And then God forbid if you get different punishments which have to run separately. If they run concurrently, at least your term will run concurrently.
Yes, yes.
So you may have, you know, the magnitude of punishments can vary. But one of the punishments, the highest punishments rather, is about 10 lakhs of rupees. And that is when you damage a computer or a computer system, wherein you, you know, you basically get into a network unauthorizedly, you affect the rights of this particular person, you disrupt or you cause damage to any of his hardware, or you deny or cause the denial of access, you prevent access.
Yes, yes.
So all these are all clubbed together, and the punishment is like 10 lakhs of rupees.
That was the fine that you'll have to pay.
That is the fine you'll have to pay.
Okay.
And there are other punishments, like for every category of wrong, because you have this section 66A, B, C, 65, 68.
Uh-huh.
Each of these sections have different punishments. But in short, I think the least punishment you can expect under the IT Act is a sum of 25,000 rupees. And that is when no punishment has been specifically laid down, but yet
for
it is
that.
A case of a crime under the Information Technology Act. So that's the kind of punishment you're looking at. Quite different from the regime of punishments under the Indian Penal Code.
Okay.
The IPC was enacted in the year 1860, which is a colonial law.
Very.
And
true.
Then what can you expect at that time? 100 rupees is a huge fine.
It's a huge fine.
But those fines weren't revised. Instead, they brought in more law. And the the Information Technology Act supplements the Indian Penal Code in the punishments that it gives.
And the punishments, as you said, are huge. You know, the amount are so different as compared to the...
Really, I mean, they are supposed to serve as a deterrent so that, you know, you don't get into the realm of cyber crimes. That was the reason why such huge punishments were laid down.
Okay. So now we are talking about cyber crimes and punishment. One thing that does come to my mind is hacking. Now, we know that hacking is bad and it's evil, this, that. But then there are times when hacking is required. See, there's a terrorist organization and the government wants to hack into their account to come to know the names of the terrorist or say what are their plans. So what is ethical and unethical hacking, and where does one draw the line?
Yeah, that's actually the debate on what is ethical and unethical in hacking. Is on, and
it's still on. Oh, so there's no conclusion yet.
There's no conclusion. The reason is because the difference is more of moral and less of technical, and morality is always subjective.
Very true. Very
so,
true. Because technically it's the same, you know, you're still hacking.
And technically
it's the same.
They say there's no difference, it's identical.
Nothing. Yeah,
but then the common question that is raised today is that, you know, is ethical hacking justified? And to what extent is it justified?
Very true.
So what happens is we have actually something called black hat, then we have white hat and grey hat. So these are the three terminologies that I use.
Uh-huh.
The black hat is purely unethical hacking.
Okay.
So unethical as in whatever you are doing is because of your personal gains.
Mm.
Then you have the white hat, and the white hat is clearly ethical hacking.
Mm.
And this is where on probably on behalf of a company or you know, there's a speculation of some loopholes in the context of security of the system,
okay,
where a person is actually employed for it.
Yes.
So that
see, the company employs a person to hack into the own company's system just to find the loophole.
Yeah, this is purely ethical, and this is what we call white hat. And the grey hat is the one which looks like a white hat, but actually it is unethical. But the difference here is that there is no direct personal gain, but it's still unethical because you're not authorized.
Oh.
And the bottom line is that when you're not authorized, your work is not considered correct.
Okay.
But then authorized will depend on whether there is a permission given to you or not.
Mm.
But sometimes, you know, you're not permitted, but you still go out of the way to do something.
True.
So those are the gray
areas,
and they're called gray hat hackers.
Like, even probably your intention might be good to do something good, but then you are not authorized.
You're not authorized.
So you're still invading someone's private space. So is it correct or is it wrong?
So this morality, the one that keeps you on the fence, is what
and I think this question will actually continue forever, because you'll have many opinions about it.
But there is a demand and there is a popularity for ethical hacking, and therefore I think,
and people do make a career.
They do make a career. Yeah, in fact there are courses offered.
And coming to that, okay, there was this student who actually likes hacking, and I know many people, you know, like they talk about their children and they say they're always on the computer. I don't know what they're doing. They're on the computer. And then these children, they, you know, sometimes you meddle here, do this, do that, do that. What if there's a situation wherein a child, as I said, doing this, doing that, by mistake, hacks into an account, hacks into someone's account. Now, this was done unintentionally by mistake, but it's still hacking. So what would be the punishment to this?
Now,
would there be a punishment?
That's a very tricky question. The reason is, when you say a child, now way back in 1860 in the Indian Penal Code, there were some ages that were, you know, laid down. A child below 7 is not an offender, whatever the child may do. Yeah, we call that child doli incapax. That means incapable of doing wrong.
Okay.
Then there is an area between 7 and 12. And most of the kids would fit in here.
Yeah, okay? Who start all that? Yeah.
And above 12, we consider the person as having a mind of his own and would be guilty and liable whenever such acts come into question. But the point here is, now the guilt and the guilty mind, we call it mens rea. In criminal law, we call it mens rea.
Okay, okay.
So finally, it's a crime.
Yes.
And there must be a guilty mind.
Okay.
Okay. So the prosecution would have to prove that there was a guilt. So in the case where you say by mistake, unintentionally, there was a case of some person who strayed, would not be made punishable, would not be liable, unless there is a monetary gain, unless there is some commercial, you know, gain in the whole thing. In that case, you would have to restore the gain to the person. But being a child, and since you asked me the question
specifically as a child,
then this thing makes a difference. But if it's an adult, then I think things are different, because in civil law there is no fine as such, but then you have to compensate. So the same thing may not be a wrong in criminal law, because there is no guilty mind, but it's still a wrong in civil law. And a civil court will have jurisdiction to actually award what we call damages, which is compensation to the person whose rights have been affected.
Okay, and
the damages also would be high.
It would be,
because the IT Act is otherwise talking about these high
quantum. And the damages anyways in these cases would be high. You know,
Ought to be high. The stakes are so high that everything...
Stakes are high. Yes, actually the stakes are high.
Would have to be high.
True. Okay, so now we are talking about the internet, and we are talking about different crimes regarding the internet. Of lately, we see the social networking and social media, and anything gets put up on social media, be it, I mean, anything, you know.
Really?
And there are, sadly, there are moments when there's an accident, rather than going and helping the person, it's recorded, it's put on the media. A confrontation between two people, rather than going and mediating and solving the issue, people record it, put it on social networking sites. Okay. So now, supposing one person finds, say, their accident pictures or their a confrontation or something personal put up by another person on a social networking site, can that person actually file a case against the other person? Do they have grounds for it?
Certainly they can file a case, but then we are not under the Information Technology Act, because the IT Act was meant for a cyber crime per se. And the crime there, again, I was talking about a guilty mind, and there's something called an act. So we call it mens rea and actus reus. So actus reus is the act, whatever the person does. Now here there is going to be an act, but there won't be a guilty mind in the sense that people are crazy. They just want to, you know, upload stuff. They want to be the first to report some crime on the road or whatever. Now that's where this is fundamentally a civil wrong. And this is where the you know, the right of privacy of an individual gets exposed more than the use of computers, the use of the internet, and violation of your rights vis-a-vis the internet. So here, I don't see it basically as a cyber crime. But it's no doubt a very serious wrong. It is equivalent to defamation.
Of course.
And it is something wherein your violation under Article 21 of the Constitution of India, which says that nobody should affect my right to privacy.
Yes,
and
very true.
Compensation there would also have a very high magnitude.
Okay.
Because the law of the land recognizes an individual and his privacy as supreme.
Okay.
As supreme.
Okay. Okay, now let me twist the question slightly. What if the intention was defamation? You know, what if a person actually puts up something to, you know, defame a person?
Then it would squarely come within the first category that we looked at. We looked
that
at a category
against person, against crime person, against person.
And cyber defamation, because he's using the internet, it would take a, you know, a different magnitude than ordinary defamation.
Okay,
and definitely it becomes a cyber crime.
Okay.
And you have both, of course, civil remedies are there, but the Information Technology Act would directly be applicable.
Okay. And now,
but the what's very important is whenever there is prosecution, the prosecutor has to prove that there was this guilty mind which you were referring to.
Oh, so the guilty mind plays an important role
in criminal.
Okay. So say supposing now a person does find themselves on the receiving end of this, okay? A person is defamed, or some compromising pictures of, say, a girl are put up on a social media. What is the procedure? In brief, if you can tell us that, she can actually sort it.
Yeah, very briefly, I'll say that one good thing the IT Act has done is that it has removed all those boundaries of jurisdiction that are there in our you know, tier system of going to the
this code, that code.
Here you can go to any of the cyber cells.
Okay.
So there's a global jurisdiction, and a complaint can be filed before any cell. And I'm not just referring to the example that you gave of compromising position, pictures and all. It also applies to
any of the fraudulent acts.
In fact, one of my colleagues was complaining this morning that there was a deduction, unauthorized deduction she felt. And she said that that's seen as a scam now. It's almost 9,000 or 10,000 rupees removed from her account.
Okay,
it was a debit card that she was using, and she says, I don't even shop online. So now she was working out as to how to, you know, complain. So I was telling her that there's no, this global jurisdiction is there.
Okay.
All you have to remember is that you have to collect certain important documents.
Okay.
That's very important.
All
because
right.
if you do not satisfy the cyber cell that these things are, you know, if it's a defamation, then you'll need pictures of that, because today people have the habit of deleting things and all that. So you'll have to create your record properly and you'll have to place it before them. After that, we find that it is going to be referred to a, you know, a regular court of session wherein the police are going to conduct their own investigation
and
they'll prepare a charge sheet.
Okay,
so
that's what happens regularly.
Yeah, the regular criminal procedure code, the CRPC and the Indian Evidence Act will continue to work, but the crime would be considered as a cyber crime, and of course stakes would be high.
And to end this is a criminal law, not a civil law.
Not a civil law.
Yeah, so people who are engaging in any of these activities, you all will be tried also as a criminal law.
As a criminal, of course.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. De Silva, for coming to Kaido and telling us about the cyber law, I mean the cyber crimes that come under the IT law. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Today we saw about the cyber crimes, and it's really interesting to see that there are different types of cyber crimes, and under that there are so many different areas. It's like your real world. It's actually a combination of all the criminal laws that we have in the real world.
Using cyberspace.
Yes, using cyberspace. So it's an intensive and extensive law That is the IT law that we have here.
True.
Yes. So, as I said, we learned about what are the different cyber laws that you have out there. And also, if you do find yourself on the receiving end of it, how you can go and get justice. As I always say, you'll have any feedbacks, you'll want to get back in touch with us, please WhatsApp us on the number you see below. You can also send us an email on the email ID you see below. Till then, it's me, Andrew D'Souza, signing off. Thank you.